Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Bring Up. I'm Bridget Green.
And I'm Kevin Weber. And today we are bringing up Ryzen Threadripper.
So good to have you here, finally.
I was into this way before it was cool, so you wouldn't understand.
I have hot goss.
Bring up. The Bring Up.
Bridget.
She's dead. Bring up.
No. Damn it.
I think I'm good.
Okay. Okay, Kevin, tell the people why we're here.
Well, we are here because there has been such an incredible torrent of cool new stuff coming out of AMD recently, and we've got just a lot more in the months ahead. So we wanted a venue to bring that information to you guys as directly and quickly as possible.
We'll be talking about all things AMD, so that's everything from servers to graphics cards to CPUs.
And on top of that, we're going to be bringing in guests, each of whom are experts in their field, and they're going to have lots of cool little tidbits and inside info that you can only get right here.
In just a second here, we'll have Robert Halleck, the one, the only, the very well-dressed, come answer some questions about the second-gen AMD Ryzen Threadripper.
Voted best dressed by PC Magazine.
No. So when I let Kevin know that this episode we're going to be talking about the second-gen Ryzen Threadripper, he promptly sent me like a manifesto of several hundred pages of why he loves it so much. So
yeah.
I won't keep him. I know he's very antsy to start talking to you about it. So what makes it so special?
Well, I've got two in front of me right here. This I've actually got the original 1950X, and then this is the 2990WX.
Thick.
It's thick with two C's. It's a beefy boy, and the reason behind that is it's not actually just one processor. It's technically four smaller processors in one large package. It's called an MCM, or like multi-chip module, or sometimes it's called a chiplet design. One of the advantages of having such a big chip is the amount of surface area that you've got. All of that is going to be conducting heat away from the chips themselves. So it's actually really easy to, even though this is such a high power part, it's really easy to keep this thing cool. I've got a cooler on. This is the same chip I have in my workstation. And I've got a cooler that isn't even full coverage. It just sort of like sits sort of here in the center. And it keeps it perfectly within spec even when I'm running at 100%.
I'm very happy for you.
Yes, I am too.
That this has come into your life.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a big upgrade from what I had before. I went to a Ryzen 7, I think 1800X, and that was like a night and day, complete difference from what I was used to. Ryzen on its own already has incredible multitasking, but then I went from the Ryzen 7 to the Ryzen Threadripper, and that was like
the
a whole
gen.
New world. The first gen, and that was a whole new world. I just wasn't used to that kind of performance. And then I went from first gen to second gen, and that was like even crazier. So I'm at a point where I think I've finally reached a point where it's like, I've got a little bit more performance than I actually know what to do with most of the time. And that's where you want to be in a creative environment.
Yeah.
You don't want to be like limited by your, you know, what by your hardware. You always want it to be a step ahead of where you're trying to be.
Creative freedom is a huge plus when you're working with something like this. But I know stability is also a really huge thing in your workflow, and that the second gen Threadripper takes only the top bin silicon.
Yes.
So really like a testament.
The fact that it's only like the highest quality or the top bin silicon, like you said.
Creme de la creme.
The creme de la creme, exactly. So because of that, you know that you are getting a part that has been like tried and true, tested over and over again, already even before it gets into your hands. I mean, like I said, if you have a render that's going over the weekend and you come back and find out that it crashed halfway through, that's a huge deal. That's like life-disruptingly bad in a lot of cases. And if you're especially paranoid, Threadripper also allows you to use ECC RAM, which is like an error-correcting RAM. It's a super special server-grade RAM that has its own circuitry that prevents it from like developing errors at all. And I think recently the error rate of that RAM is like down to 0.0% or something. Like it's crazy, crazy, you know, like you'll never run into an issue kind of field of RAM.
Wish I had that kind of track record.
I know, yeah, that would be nice, wouldn't it? If you could say like, oh yeah, I mess up 0.0% of the time. Now I'm still stuck in that kind of like mentality where I keep opening stuff and closing it. But every time I go back and like look at my RAM usage, or like look at my CPU usage, it's like 20% when I've got four different Adobe programs open.
Well, you were talking a little bit about how the Threadripper gets put through the paces before you even receive it on the consumer end. And you got to go to one of the labs the other day and kind of see some of that testing.
Yeah, I got to go to one of the labs here. There's a dozen, I think. And I got to see one of the tests they do out of the scores and scores. And I was already kind of blown away at like the crazy military grade stuff they put these poor chips through before they ever get in your hands. So, yeah, I don't want to, no spoilers.
No spoilers.
But
we'll cut to the clip.
We'll cut to the clip. So now we're in the shock and vibe room, and I'm standing next to a giant electromagnet that jostles electronic parts around.
I think it does more than jostle. It actually can hit hard. This is what's called a shaker table. It's basically a big speaker. We can either do shock pulses to simulate dropping something, so an impact. Or we can do any type of vibration, random vibration, swept vibration. So we'll do board level shocks, or we'll do whole systems.
It looks just like a...
Looks like the back slot of, back yep. panel of a...
It's even got the little screws in here.
Yeah, wouldn't you like to have that chassis? You've got accelerometers to measure what you actually put into it. Mm-hmm. And also there'll be accelerometers that you're gonna put on the device. The goal here is to make sure something doesn't fly off. So if you look at the Wraith Ripper, that's a big heat sink. It's gonna have to have reduced shock loads because it's so big and you don't wanna have it damage itself or damage the board.
Is there
danger
of shrapnel?
You definitely don't wanna be in the room when you're testing for shock. You would definitely come in and set this up and get out just in case something does go flying. That's the highlight of my day, to be able to break something.
All right, everybody, that does it here for us today in this lab, but there's about 15 more labs, and there's still like a lot of really cool equipment here that we haven't even touched on, so stay tuned because there's a lot more coming. Thanks, Kevin. So we've subjected Threadripper to a battery of shock tests, but now I'm going to submit myself for the same thing.
Yes, while that package was airing, I spent the last minute Googling the best shocking facts the internet has to serve up. I would like to say I have not fact-checked any of these.
100% true.
And I won't. Kevin, just for reference, can you show us what it would look like if you were shocked? Oh, yeah.
Is that good?
Yeah. And okay. What would it look like if you weren't shocked? So I think now we're ready to go. Okay. Let's see what we've got here. Did you know that humans are the only animals whose brains shrink? Okay. I think that's about a 2. The small bumps on the F and J buttons on the keyboard are there to help you find the optimum typing position.
That's just something you learn in typing class.
Yeah, right,
that's
not, okay. A light bulb in California has been burning for 113 years.
I knew that one. It's in a fire station.
Chameleons don't change color to blend into their surroundings. When they change color, it's actually an emotional and psychological state that they're in.
I do the same thing, so.
I was named after a dog that my mom met once.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Still ahead, we've got the best dressed man in PC, Mr. Robert Halleck, coming out to talk about second gen AMD Ryzen Threadripper.
But now, a word from our sponsors. This episode of The Bring Up is brought to you by the HP Envy X360, powered by AMD Ryzen mobile processors with Radeon Vega graphics. Designed for work or play, this convertible slim and light notebook is perfect for the commuter on the go. Create, surf, stream, and connect all at once without missing a beat. And with AMD's Ryzen mobile processors with Radeon Vega graphics, you'll get that extraordinary multitasking performance and graphics clarity that you wouldn't expect in a thin and light notebook. For more information, visit amd.com/RyzenMobile.
All right, we are very excited to have Robert Halleck, very smart person from what I've heard, good D&D player on the show with
us. Very good D&D player, yes.
Mm-hmm. What's your current character?
A bard. I decided to play a bard, which, anybody who's played D&D knows that's a bizarre choice and probably undesirable, but it's a lot of fun.
It's good for a big group, though.
It's good for a big group.
Yeah, because it's
where you don't have to fight
stuff.
Or heal or...
What's your bard's name?
Vexos, V-E-X-O-S.
Very cool. Yeah. Let's just change the lower third to Vexos.
Yeah, just do it. Tiefling Bard. Perfect. Let's do it.
Well, as much as we'd like to talk about D&D,
could do it all
maybe
day.
We
Forever.
Will later. Sure. We also want to talk about second generation AMD Ryzen Threadripper.
Threadripper.
So we have some hot topics we have collected.
Yep.
Ooh.
Well, we were trying really hard to come up with a name for this hot topic segment.
Okay.
We have a few bad options for you, and you can pick which one we use.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. Let's do it.
The first one is, AMAMD.
That's not bad.
It's possible. AMAMD. It's a possibility.
Okay, so
the second one is Chipping Away with Robert Halleck.
Oh, come on. That's just dreadful.
He doesn't like that.
No, I don't like that.
I liked Shooting the Chip with Robert Halleck.
Ooh, that is perhaps the most dad joke of the book. That's not bad.
Yeah, I
like that
one.
What do you think?
Let's go with AMAMD.
Okay, we'll stick
Everybody,
with that.
Welcome to AMAMD with Robert Halleck.
One of the things that I don't 100% understand is SMT in Threadripper mm-hmm. and Ryzen and Zen just in general. So I'm aware that it's kind of similar to the way that Intel does hyper-threading, but it's also a little bit different. So I'm just curious how that kind of all is handled
sure.
and what level of hardware handles that.
So I guess as to set the foundation, SMT is the idea that your in the processor, you have sort of two pieces, a dispatch unit, which sort of receives work from the operating system and sends it through the CPU, and you have the execution engine, which the dispatch unit dispatches work to. And so in an SMT system, you duplicate the dispatch area, but you keep one execution area. Mm-hmm. So you have two ways to intake work and one way to execute work. CPUs and, well, just any sort of processor, graphics, CPUs in general, there are times where the processor has to pause to think effectively. We call it a pipeline bubble, where there's a gap in time where the CPU is waiting on something else in the system to provide information or data.
And that could be like a drive or a GPU?
Sure, it could be a file load. It could be retrieving something from CPU cache. Like, there's a million ways that a pipeline bubble can be created. Mm-hmm. And so what SMT does is recognize that point where the pipeline is stalled for whatever reason, and the other dispatch unit injects useful data into the execution engine. So huh. that pipeline bubble is now filled with useful work and you don't have a stall anymore. And so that's what SMT attempts to do.
How is that similar to like async compute, the new Vega GPUs?
It's actually quite similar. Asynchronous compute and SMT are quite similar in that we're attempting to fill stalled pipelines mm-hmm. with useful information. Async compute is slightly different in that on a graphics card, there's memory accesses, there's graphics rendering work, and my graphics engineers would kill me if I got this wrong. So let's just say there's a third one, mm-hmm. a third category
mystery.
Of mystery. Category. I wrote a blog about this one time, but I've forgotten. Lost to the haze of time. There's a third category of data, and in an old setup, an old non-asynchronous setup, each one of those has to be processed serially. Mm. And in an asynchronous compute setup, there's three separate pipelines, one for data, one for the geometry work, and one for that mystery third category. And they all kind of execute independently and come together at the end. But basic gist, fill the bubbles in the pipeline.
Sure.
Now, in terms of actual implementation, you know, that starts to get into the confidential secret sauce, trade secret stuff.
Between us friends.
But we'll get it someday, don't worry.
Man, we'll think break him.
You will not break me. No, I like my job.
Block the doors.
I think one of the things that people have found and proven objectively is that oftentimes the Ryzen implementation of SMT tends to be a hair more efficient than, let's say, our competitor's implementation. And that's testable objectively by running a piece of code with SMT off, like a highly scalable piece of work, Cinebench is a great example, with SMT off, and then turn it on and chart the performance uplift. You know, a more efficient SMT implementation for the same number of cores and threads will get a slightly better result. And so we've seen that from third-party analysis in the past and a couple tests on our end. But you know, the other thing too is that not every game or not every application takes great advantage of SMT.
Right.
And so it's not widely known, but what a lot of game developers do is deliberately schedule their game to only run on physical CPU cores. Instead of using the SMT dispatch engines, they'll use one dispatch straight through the pipe and out the other side. And there are lots of ways to do that as a developer, but you know, for multi-threaded work, SMTs, great stuff.
Sure. Yeah, that's one of the things that interests me a lot is the concept of, you know, because I do a lot of workstation work where it's going to be video or 3D, sure. and it's just me sitting there kind of waiting for stuff to happen, which is why I like the Threadripper 2990WX so much, is because I've got a lot more cores that are going to be able to eat up all that work. But it really frustrates me when I have something that I'm trying to get completed or see a render get done, and I'm using like 9% of my CPU. Mm-hmm. And so the concept of CPU time, that's just sort of being left on the table when there's cores sitting idle, when like, why aren't you just working on this extra stuff?
I get it.
That's what I like. I'm really glad when I see an application where I hit the render button or I hit the like do some work button, just fills it up at 100% and it's done in like 9 seconds.
Yeah, and to that point, the applications that tend to do best with SMT or just multi-core in general are just heavy mathematical computation. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you peel back the layers of the user interface, those 3D rendering apps or audio encoding or video encoding, it's just gigantic math problems being run over and over and over to compress a video frame or calculate a ray of light bouncing off of a car door onto the ground. It's just physics. And so those physical math problems are very predictable. And that allows the system to achieve really high efficiency at filling those bubbles because it knows exactly what's coming next, right? It knows that math problem is just going to repeat over and over. So that's why we can scale 3D rendering, ray tracing, video to sky high.
So you mentioned the Windows is getting more and more multi-threaded, but Windows isn't the only operating system that Threadripper operates on. So I know that Linux implementation is also pretty good. So tell me about the difference between like, why would I choose Windows over Linux when I'm dealing with Threadripper?
Ooh, nuanced topic. So I want to preface this by saying that I am not a Linux expert. Linux expert is a hard-earned badge.
Yeah, you got to know how to like type code into command lines.
Command line, bash
thing.
Scripts, the whole nine yards.
It's like, a whole thing.
That, you know, that's a badge of honor that people wear. I haven't earned it. I'm a Windows user. I always have been. And it's, I think, one part what you're born into and what operating system is best for your needs. So I primarily do PC gaming, so Windows is going to be the best operating system for me.
But so you're saying that you're born a Linux user?
I think in some ways, yes. Like, I think there are people who grew up with Mac OS, for example, either in school or at home, and they continue to use Mac today. I was always Windows. I went from DOS to Windows 3.1.1 to, you know, NT 2000, yada, yada, yada. So that's all I've ever really known, and I don't really have a huge need to switch. Okay, preamble done. So the pros and cons are, I think, you know, gaming continues to have a leadership position in Windows. It has access to DirectX, which most games are written on, and that is, you know, kind of the API for graphics that game developers tend to gravitate towards, which makes Windows sort of a natural fit for anybody who wants to play PC gaming. Mm-hmm. But that's no slight against Linux, which is getting more and more potent all the time at gaming with native implementations on Vulkan, and then projects from companies like Steam that do real-time translations for games.
Yeah, they just recently came up with a new library or something that supports just like 1,000
tons of games
AAA
in the Steam
games
library.
Or something ridiculous.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're a gamer, I think one of the pros that kind of falls into the Windows camp as a pro. But what Linux is advantaged by is having so many people work on it. You know, it's an open source project. There are thousands of developers contributing to the Linux kernel. And it's really, really fast for them to update the capabilities of the operating system. So you get a product like Threadripper, especially the 2990WX with 4 dies and 2 have memory access and 2 don't. You know, there are implications for how the process scheduler in the system should take advantage of that hardware. And one of the things that the Linux community has done is built in special code to take advantage of that layout of the chip. Mm-hmm. And so websites like Phoronix recently did some reviews on those updates. And you know, the upside was great, right? And so that is an example, I think, that falls, or a pro that falls in the Linux favor, that they can update very, very quickly. And for sort of data scientists or heavy processing type workloads, Linux often, but not always, is a better choice because you can so finely tune the way that OS works with the underlying hardware.
So we have some questions as well that we've pulled from our social platforms.
Oh boy.
Oh, brace yourself. These are all related to second gen AMD Ryzen Threadripper.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay.
Unedited from the public.
Yeah.
Straight
from the
straight fire hose. Let's do
this. Yeah, look, they're all different formats because I cut and paste them.
All right, let's go, okay. Internet.
What could gamers possibly need with the 2950X? Why would this be good for gaming?
You know, truth be told, Threadripper in general is, I've long believed that it is a better fit for content creation. That's sort of what it's designed to do. And that's not to say that it can't game, it's just it's better at content creation. That said, you know, looking at the third-party analysis, the 2950X is not all that far away from the 2700X, the normal Ryzen 7 2700X in terms of gaming performance. And what that does allow you is the flexibility to have that high-end content creation that Threadripper offers with gaming performance that's pretty close to our best gaming CPU as well. And that's not a bad trade-off for people who dip their toes in both, right?
Sure.
Maybe you take your work home and finish the rendering project, and then you just want to play a game, right? Mm-hmm. So having a Threadripper on hand is sort of that between both worlds CPU that other chips maybe don't address.
Do you have any secrets, hot goss you can share with us?
The worst. Okay, yes, I have hot goss. Okay.
Oh, you do?
Hot goss alert.
terrible. Okay, so thinking back to first-gen Threadripper, we released a version of Ryzen Master that allowed people to switch between local mode and distributed mode. Mm-hmm. And behind the scenes, what that would do is tweak the behavior of the system to prefer like the lowest possible memory latency, that's local mode, or the highest possible memory bandwidth, and that's distributed mode. And there was a clear benefit when you paired a certain application with the right mode. There was, you know, sometimes 10 or even 20% uplift, especially games. Games loved local mode for the memory latency reasons. So one of the things that was somewhat contentious, though, is that toggling between the two requires a system reboot. So the benefits are great, but it's kind of awkward to reboot your computer. So we've been thinking about how to make that a little better, especially when you get to a product like the Threadripper 2990WX, which now has four CPU dies, right? Two have memory and two don't. Mm-hmm. So that possibility that an application could want direct memory access, benefit from it, and not get it because it's on another die, that possibility increases. So the question becomes, what if you could give that local memory access benefit without impacting the apps that just love to spread across as many cores as possible with high memory bandwidth? That is possible. We built a tool called dynamic local mode, which it works something like this. When a process runs, say you start Notepad. Notoriously demanding Notepad. You see, you know, notepad.exe in the task manager, but behind the scenes, it spawns one or more threads of work. And those threads get assigned to CPU cores. And so what we do is we look at all the threads in flight on the system, not the processes, but the threads themselves, and count how many CPU cycles those threads have consumed. In other words, asking how important or how demanding is this thread? And then we rank them from highest to lowest demand. And then we say, okay, the top 16 threads or the most demanding threads, we're going to schedule those. We're going to restrict them to running on the dies with local memory access first. So it's possible to look at Task Manager and spawn a really highly threaded app, and you'll see tasks get bounced to other cores as our utility kicks in and manages the apps to these specific dies with direct memory access. And any thread that doesn't fit inside those CPU dies with direct memory access, maybe they're full, maybe those dies are full, our tool has consumed all of those resources, the other threads will just go by the default window scheduler behavior to use the remaining CPU dies and cores. So the end result is that those lightly threaded applications that would prefer direct memory access or local memory access, guaranteed to get that when our tool kicks in and pushes them there. And any of the threads or any of the processes that just go wide and use every core and thread available, no impact, right? The tool is going to direct the first 16 or 32 threads to those initial dies, and then the other ones will just go to the non-RAM dies, and nothing changes. It's business as usual. Mm-hmm. So we're still working through the performance benefits, but they can be substantial when you get those apps always running in their correct mode. So this is a tool we're developing for Windows. It will run in the background as a system service. It will be an optional package in our chipset driver. So one day you'll go download the newest version of the AMD chipset driver. And if you want, it will install this service in the background and just constantly poke processes onto the fastest die available for that workload. And so that's pretty cool. We get benefits of local mode and distributed mode on these four die chips. And get a performance benefit out of it, and the user doesn't have to do anything but install our chipset driver, which they're going to do anyway.
Easy enough.
So there is the hot goss.
You heard it here first, folks. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course.
For coming on with us.
Thank you for having me.
I know that we'll make you do it again.
Yeah, you will on AMD.
AMD. I forgot what it was called.
By Robert Halleck. Please be sure to like and subscribe. And if you have questions or topics you'd like us to cover in the future, please leave them in a comment below. And if we get 5,000 likes on this video, we will get Lisa Su as a guest for our very next episode.
Thank you so much for watching. We have a little treat for those of you who stuck around through the end of the episode. And tune in next time to see what we bring up.
Here I'm grinding and throwing sparks on a processor for no apparent reason.
Bring up. Bring up. Bring up. Bring up. Bring up.